Hello friends, Namaskar. In today's video or today's coverage, I have taken a bit serious topic, that is the filing of ITR in the case of a deceased person. The basic purpose of today's video is to bring attention of the legal hires who are supposed to file the ITR of a deceased person. So through this video, I will try to put up the nitty-gritty relating to the issue and all income tax related aspects in a summarized manner. So let's go further. So my dear friends, in form of coverage, what are the key questions which we are going to resolve through this particular session? When it is required to file ITR of a deceased person? This is a very important question, that when you are required to file the ITR of a deceased person, which ITR form to be filled? This is also a significant question. Who may file return of a deceased person? This is a very, very important question, that who is the person who is responsible for filing the ITR of the deceased person? What is the definition of legal representative? This is a must to know thing. How to file ITR of a deceased person and what are the relevant documents thereof? Are you liable to pay tax dues of a deceased person? Somebody may say, sir, since that person has died, so I am not supposed to pay any tax liability of the deceased. We will see the answer to this question also. And can a legal representative claim refund of a deceased person? This is something really very beneficial, that if a person has died, then whether the legal representative can claim refund which is due to him, and if yes, then what is the process thereof? This is also we will see. So the first and foremost question which I am putting up before you is to answer it, when it is required to file ITR of a deceased person. How would you decide that you are liable to file the ITR of a deceased person? To come to an answer to this question, I have put up certain points here, my dear friends. One, whether there was any taxable income in the hands of a deceased person up to the date of death for the relevant financial year. Say for example, if a person has died on 30th of September 2020, then whether from 1st of April 2020 to 30th of September 2020, there was any taxable income in that person's hands? If your answer is a pure no, then there is no worry to file the ITR at all. Secondly, whether such income was above basic exemption limit or not. See, if the income was below basic exemption limit, say for example, presently the basic exemption limit is 2.5 lakh. For senior citizen, it could be 3 lakh or 5 lakh as the case may be. So if the total income was up to those limits, then I can again say that there is nothing to worry about in terms of filing return. A very significant question which we need to understand is whether any tax was deducted, which is also appearing in form 26S of the deceased. If there was a tax which is deducted, even if there is no taxable income, I keep on suggesting, sir, please file the return, because this will help you in two ways. One, the tax compliance in the eyes of the income tax department would be said to be done. And secondly, you will be also be able to claim a refund thereof. And whether any real estate or share market transactions or booking of FDs, etc. was conducted by the deceased person in the year of death. See, sometimes the real estate related deals, share market related transaction, FD booking, etc. appear on the radar of the income tax department. So even if the person has died and you are not going to comply with any ITR related things, then at a future date, you may be facing income tax related query. So it would be better that rather than income tax department asking you to be aware to file the ITR of such person, you should go forward on your own and file the return of such person on your own. Now, my dear friends, to put my point more clearly, I am putting up here an example under which I have considered two persons, Mr. X and Mr. Y. Say the date of death of Mr. X was 10th of October 2020 and that of Mr. Y was 15th of July 2020. And the total income for the financial year, that is financial year 2021, say in the case of Mr. X was Rs 2,10,000 and in the case of Mr. Y, it was Rs 6,75,000. Let's assume their age was say 55 years. Now, whether ITR is a must for the assessment year 21-22, that is financial year 2021, in the case of Mr. X, assuming that his GTI is also not exceeding basic exemption limit, My answer is clear no. I am assuming that there is no TDS deducted. I am assuming that there is no real estate, no FD booking, no share market transaction. However, in the case of Mr. Y, since the total income has already exceeded 2.5 lakh rupees, it is always advisable for his legal heir to file the return on behalf of him. Now, one more interesting question which we would be looking from the point of view of getting an answer is whether ITR will be required for the assessment year 22-23 onwards. Then the answer is clear no. Why there is an answer of clear no? Because since the person has died, there does not arise a question of filing ITR in the subsequent financial years, in the subsequent assessment year. But one point which I would like to mention here is, unfortunately, sometime it happens that a person has died and his FDs related interest are still being deducted in his name only. Then subsequently, if the legal heirs doesn't go or doesn't reach out to the bank and they don't inform to the bank in time, TDS even for a subsequent year may be continued to be deducted in the name of the deceased person. This may create problem from the point of view of this answer getting a no here, because the TDS is deducted in the name of the deceased even after his death. So ideally what should happen in the case of person's death, if you reach out to the bank, to the financial institution and inform them that look, this person has died and now please don't deduct TDS in the name of this person. We are the legal heir. Please deduct TDS in the name of the legal heir. That would be a right approach rather than the TDS continuously being deducted in the name of the deceased person. I hope you would take care of this point. Now comes the question, which ITR form to be filed? Here my simple answer is, sir, that basically the ITR form depends upon, or it is required to be filed according to the relevant assessment year forms which are notified by the central government, and this could range from ITR 1, ITR 2, ITR 3 to ITR 4. So your chartered accountant, your tax consultant would be finally helpful to you in determining which ITR form you should be filing for the deceased person from ITR 1 to ITR 4 in the case of an individual. Another question which we need to have a solution is, who may file return of a deceased person? A very interesting question, sir. Sometimes there are persons who are eager to file the return of the deceased person. Sometimes there is nobody who is going to take the responsibility of filing the return. So technically, if I would like to answer it, I would say the ITR of a deceased person should be filed by a legal representative of him. So therefore, the another question which comes here is, who is a legal representative? So to answer this, I would refer to the provisions of section 2 clause 29 of the Income Tax Act 1961, dear friends, which says legal representative has the meaning assigned to it in clause 11 of section 2 of the Code of Civil Procedure 1908. So you would say, Mr. Bhatia, I could not get you that what is actually the meaning of LR. This is referring to Code of Civil Procedure. So now I take you to the procedure of Code of Civil Procedure, that okay, what is the definition of this term as per Code of Civil Procedure 1908. So see, this definition of legal representative is also there before you as per Code of Civil Procedure 1908, which says legal representative means a person who in law represents the estate of a deceased person. So, who generally represents the estate of a deceased person, my dear friend? His close kith and kin, maybe wife, maybe son, maybe daughter, maybe any legal heir as per the relevant succession act, may it be Muslim law, may it be Hindu law, according to those law, whatever will be the legal representative, that legal representative will be taken from the person who is succeeding to that person who has deceased. Another thing is, it would include any person who intermeddles with the estate of the deceased. So any person who has interference over the estate of the deceased would also be treated to be legal representative in the eyes of the law. And where a party sues or is sued in a representative character, the person on whom the estate devolves on the death of the party so suing or sued. So if there is ultimately a person who is claiming, look, there are certain assets of this person and I am so-called honor subsequent to him, I am representing his case, then the person who is so representing the deceased in the eyes of the law, such person will be treated to be legal representative. Now we will see the answer to the question that, okay sir, what is the procedure to file the ITR of a deceased person? Now here I would suggest that if you can log on to the e-filing, this is the portal address, then you have to go to your own PAN. Say for example, if X has died and Y is claiming to be his LR, then Y has to log in through his own PAN, who is the successor or who is the legal representative. In my account menu located at upper left side of the page, he has to click register as representative. So you need not to log in to the PAN of the person who has deceased. You have to log in the PAN of yours, then you have to go into my account, and there you have to click at register as representative. Then you have to do a request type there, that is either you are doing a new request or select the category to register. Then you have to select the category deceased legal heir, and then you have to click for proceed. Now while you will proceed for, it will ask you to provide the details like who is the person who has deceased, what was his PAN number. Now what are the further details which are required here? Some of them would be required to be filled up, like PAN of the deceased, surname of the deceased, middle name of the deceased, first name of the deceased, date of the death, bank account details of the legal heir. That is the person who is representing legal heir, his bank details should be given. This is very much important. You need not to give the bank account details of the person who has deceased. You have to give the bank account details. My dear friends, it is very important to note that department would not accept anybody as the legal representative of the deceased person. They would certainly ask you to submit certain documents which are to be attached. What are those documents? It is asking that you have to attach the following document as attachment against the hyperlink provided for the same. What will be those documents? Copy of the PAN card of the deceased, copy of the PAN card of the legal heir, copy of the death certificate, copy of the legal heir proof from the below mentioned list. This is one of the most important points covered herein, that which are the legal heir related proofs which will be accepted by the IT department. One, it could be legal heir certificate which is issued by the court of law or local revenue authority. It could be a panchayat samiti certificate, municipal record certificate, where they have accepted you as the legal heir of the deceased. Surviving family member certificate issued by the local revenue authority. Family pension certificate issued by central government, state government, where a person dies and he was a pensioner, then his or her spouse who is holding a family pension certificate may submit that form here, may upload that form here. A registered will would also suffice, and therefore, sir, I've seen from my experience that people in India are normally not having the habit of writing the will. And even that too, getting a registered will is a rarely found practice. So if you can provoke people at large for getting a will prepared and also registering it, that could help them in solving lot of the issues, even not only income tax related but other also. Letter issued by the banking or financial institution, this is most commonly used one. Letter issued by the banking or financial institution on their letterhead with official seal and signature mentioning the particular of nominee or joint account holder to the account of the deceased at the time of demise. See, sometime what happens, if a person is undergoing certain treatment or is undergoing certain illness or who is too old at his age, if they hold a nomination in their bank or if they hold any particular kind of joint holding in their account, then that would be basically helpful to their successors in claiming their tax dues at a future date. This list of documents further continues. I would add two more points here. One, copy of the order passed in the name of the deceased, mandatory only if the reason for registration is filing of an appeal against an order passed in the name of the deceased. So if you are going to file an appeal in the name of the deceased, then in that case an order passed in the name of deceased, that is you are filing an appeal and already an assessment order is passed in the name of deceased, then that particular copy of order would be required. And the copy of order or notice, mandatory only if the reason for registration is filing of the return of income form for the period in which the deceased was alive through condonation request or a notice or order received from the income tax department in the name of applicant for compliance on behalf of deceased. Sir, sometime what may happen, a person who died was suffering from illness and he could not file his return for even last 1 or 2 years. And when You took over the charge as legal representative. You came to know that such person was entitled to claim substantial refund. But by the time you become in charge of such particular activity, the time of filing return has already elapsed. So what you can do, then you can file a request in form of delay condonation request for accepting return of the deceased person with a belated condonation. If you are doing so, then that particular copy of order passed under section 119 would be required. Now, my dear friends, a very important question to be answered is, are you liable to pay tax dues of a deceased person? Because usually, if there is a single legal hire, no issues, he has to bear everything. But another thing is when there are multiple legal hires, because in the registration process on income tax department, one LR would be sufficient. But sometimes there is a fight between the LRs. And one would say, okay, if a person had three sons, everybody of them is wishing to claim their particular portion of the asset of the deceased, but nobody of them or none of them is ready to pay the tax liability of the deceased. These are the issues which crop up before the income tax department. Now, to get an answer to this, I'm putting up, according to section 159(6) of the Income Tax Act 1961, the liability of a legal representative under this section shall, subject to provisions of subsection 4 and 5, be limited to the extent to which the estate is capable of meeting the liability. Very important point. Suppose a person has left only assets of rupees 10 lakh behind him and to a successor, and there is a tax liability of rupees 18 lakh due on him, then the successor could not be held to pay tax liability beyond 10 lakh because this is what he has succeeded. But suppose if successor has received wealth of rupees 1 crore and tax liability due is rupees 3 lakh only, then the full tax liability is recoverable from the successor. So this is one way to understand how the tax liability would be payable by the LR, that is legal representative, on behalf of a deceased person. Now a last but not least point, my dear friends, can a legal representative claim refund of the deceased person? Here, I would like to highlight the provisions of section 238 of Income Tax Act 1961, which says, person entitled to claim refund in certain special cases. Subsection 2 of it says, where through death, incapacity, insolvency, liquidation or other cause, a person is unable to claim or receive any refund due to him, his legal representative or the trustee, guardian, etc. shall be entitled, point to be noted, my dear friend, shall be entitled to claim or receive such refund for the benefit of such person or his estate. So say X died, Y is alive. After X death, some 55,000 refund is due to him. Certainly, Y, who is a successor of him, can claim the refund which is due to X in the eyes of income tax lawyer. I know, my dear friends, life is uncertain. These kind of issues may crop up anywhere. So if you come across any person who is into such kind of flux, then you may advise him to see this particular video, which may be helpful to a legal representative. In my opinion, hope you will find the content of this particular video useful. Thank you very much for being with me, listening to me. Jai Hind.